Welcome back to another episode of the Pro Overwatch News Recap. In today's installment, we have a whole bunch of Overwatch League free agency news to cover. But first, as a friendly reminder, the 2019 Overwatch World Cup kicks off on Halloween with the preliminary rounds, and all teams that fall out of the top 5 national rankings will be participating in these. And once the prelims are over, 5 teams will move on to the group stage alongside South Korea, Canada, China, France, and the United States. The group stage and the playoffs will go from November 1st all the way until November 3rd, which means that we get 4 days of action-packed Overwatch where countries around the world get to show what they've got. So make sure you tune into the World Cup from Thursday until the end of the weekend. Okay, now for the main event. Let's go over some of the big moves that occurred over the last week or so during the 2019 Overwatch League free agency period that's been going on, and I figured I'd start by addressing the elephant in the room. So if you didn't already know, the Paris Eternal shocked the world by signing Sparkle, who was arguably the most sought-after free agent from the Tier 2 scene. This move without a doubt caught a lot of people off guard, including myself. I thought Paris was pretty set on having this all EU player roster, but it would seem they had a change of heart. And I'm sure some of you may be asking yourselves, why the heck would Sparkle want to sign with an English-speaking team instead of one that's full Korean? Well, the obvious answer would be that Paris just offered him a lot more money than everybody else, right? Well, it turns out that's actually not the case at all. According to Halo of Thoughts on Twitter, who is a very reliable source when it comes to Overwatch League news, by the way, Sparkle actually turned down offers that were worth more than what Paris offered him. The reason Sparkle picked Paris instead of anybody else was because him and his Element Mystic coach Rush had a long-standing agreement that they would join the same Overwatch League team together, and since Rush landed a job as the head coach of Paris, the choice became pretty easy for Sparkle. I'm not going to lie, I'm pretty caught off guard by all of this, but I guess I should say congrats to Paris. Landing one of the biggest names in free agency is awesome, and I think he'll definitely help take this team to the next level. It is worth noting, though, that Sparkle is currently not eligible to play until his birthday on May 31st, since he doesn't meet the league's age requirement right now. So yes, the Eternal got themselves a potential superstar DPS player, but we won't see him in action until May 31st at the earliest when the Paris Eternal take on the Vancouver Titans. But guess what? The news doesn't end there for Paris. Along with Sparkle and Rush, they also signed two of Sparkle's teammates in Hanbin and Exe. And for those of you who don't know, Hanbin was Element Mystic's off-tank player and Exe played DPS. Exe is also known for his hits game, by the way, so it would seem that Soon will have competition at his position. Nonetheless though, these signings, like with the Sparkle one, are absolutely massive. The Element Mystic players are very talented, which is pretty evident by their first place finish in the Gauntlet this year. Oh, and before I forget, kind of like with Sparkle, the Eternal will be without Hanbin to start the year since he will be underaged, but luckily for Paris, he will be old enough by the 20th of February, so he'll only be unavailable for a couple of games. And believe it or not, this still isn't the end of the Eternal's offseason moves. Along with all of these Element Mystic guys, Paris also signed two other coaches. First, they got Levi, who was an assistant coach on the Dragons last year, and a former coach on Element Mystic before that. And if I had to take a guess, I would say the big reason why the Paris Eternal picked him up is because he has that Element Mystic connection. But the other coach that we have to talk about is surprisingly Aid. The former Toronto Defiant main support is set to become a coach for the first time in his career. And according to his Twitter, he is now retired from being a player and is ready to potentially turn his experience as a player into valuable coaching skills. So now Paris has completely rebuilt their coaching staff. They have themselves a coaching core of 4 Koreans. They have Rush as their head coach, plus 9K, Levi, and 8 as assistants. The Paris Eternal are seriously looking like one of the biggest winners of free agency right now. They revamped their coaching staff and signed a core of young players with high potential, and there could be more coming soon since they do need a flex DPS to play in place of Sparkle until he turns 18. And the reason I say they'll need a new flex DPS is because of the final announcement Paris made last week. So on October 23rd, they announced the release of Shadowburn, Danye, Finzi, and LH Cloudy, and all of these releases are pretty understandable, to be honest. Now, I personally wouldn't say any of these guys dominated this year by any means. All of them had their moments, but none of them were consistent playmakers. Cloudy and Finzi looked pretty good in Stage 4 in particular, but it would seem that this wasn't enough to secure their jobs next year. Plus, there was a time when both of these guys found themselves on the bench. The Finzi situation in particular was a little concerning since he got benched for Nico for a short amount of time, and he's a DPS player, so that is a little bit worrying. Then with Danye, he looked decent during the times he actually got to play, but the problem is that he didn't go on stage all that much. His DPS and Zarya weren't bad, but I don't really think he fits in with Paris if they weren't willing to involve him in the rotation all that much. Then of course, there's Shadowburn, and I'll be the first one to say it. I love this guy, I really do. I've always been a really big fan of his, but that does not change the fact that he was an average at best player for most of 2019. And during the GOATS meta, his Brig and Zarya were straight up bad. He did pop off here and there on heroes such as Pharah and Mei, but he was pretty inconsistent. Plus, if you're picking up somebody like Sparkle, then of course you don't need Shadowburn on your roster anymore. It hurts to see him be bounced by yet another team though, that's for sure. Best of luck to Shadowburn, Finzi, LH Cloudy, and Danye. Hopefully all these guys find a new home for the 2020 season. Okay, that's everything to do with the Paris Eternal in this video. Now let's go over some of the stuff that happened with my previous video real quick. So in case you haven't been keeping up with social media and you did not see my pinned comment in the last video, the Soul Dynasty officially acquired both Prophet and Jester. If Soul can go out and sign a solid support line now, then they should be a serious title contender. And I already did give my thoughts on this move in my previous video, so if you want to know what I think, make sure to check it out. But while I'm on the topic of Soul, there's a big rumor regarding them that's looking to be true since it was reported by ESPN Esports. So according to ESPN Esports Twitter, the Soul Dynasty have agreed to transfer Fleta to the Shanghai Dragons. And if this is 100% true, then that's a huge feels bad, man. I've said it before, but a Prophet and Fleta DPS line sounded so awesome. The versatility and clutch factor would be through the roof. But I guess it's too good to be true. But it's not the biggest loss in the world for Soul since they do have Prophet, and he has a very similar hero pool to Fleta, but what a pickup for Shanghai here. The Dragons just made a serious upgrade to their DPS line. Part of the reason they couldn't seem to keep up around Stage 4 was because their DPS just didn't look like they were flexible enough. Fleta can most definitely help solve this problem though, since his hero pool is so diverse. Him, Ding, and Diem could be a deadly DPS trio. And the reason I say trio is because the Dragons actually recently let go of Youngjin back on October 23rd. Now that they're supposedly getting Fleta though, I don't think it's the end of the world to see Youngjin go. Yes, he's a great Doomfist and a solid projectile player overall, but Fleta is a solid player in his own right. And if the meta desperately calls for a Doomfist, then I'm sure somebody on that team could step up. Hopefully it would be Fleta. And I don't know how you guys feel, but I'll take Fleta over Youngjin any day of the week. Great pickup by Shanghai if this does end up happening, and I'm assuming it will. Now for some of the other old news that came out shortly after my previous video. So first off, EQO and the Fusion have parted ways, making him an unrestricted free agent. And I'll be honest, losing him is pretty tough for the Fusion. He's been a reliable option for them these last 2 years, and now there's definitely a big time hole at the flex DPS position for them. They also recently said their goodbyes to Neptuno, as we all know, so now the Fusion have parted ways with two of their core six players from that 2018 playoff run. I have no doubt that both of these guys will end up on a new team though. They're far too talented not to, and there's a handful of options for each of them to explore. Make sure to let me know where you think both of them signed down in the comment section, by the way. And while we're on the topic of the Fusion, they made a few other announcements over the last couple of days. So in terms of player news, both Elk and Kib are now officially off the team and are set to become free agents. Can't really say I'm all that surprised by this stuff. Elk was a two-way player who wasn't even on Fusion University anymore to begin with, and although the Fusion traded for Kib, he never got a single second of stage time, so as far as I'm concerned, both of these guys were pretty expendable. Look for the Fusion to make some moves within the next few days though, or the next few weeks I should say. That roster is looking mighty empty right now, and they definitely have something planned. And finally, to wrap up the Fusion news I have for you, on October 25th, they announced the signing of their new head coach KDG, alongside a new assistant GM who goes by the name of Rostin. So KDG, if you didn't already know, was the head coach of the Dynasty in 2019. His coaching methods were pretty unique, and people tended to have mixed opinions on them, but regardless, he's still a decent coach. Soul did finish in the top 5 of the regular season standings, so he had to be doing something correct, right? Maybe this move works out for the Fusion. A coaching change can sometimes go a long way for a team, so we'll have to see if the signing ends up being worth it or not. Moving on to the Houston Outlaws, some of the news that I missed out on because it came out after my previous video was that they made the interesting choice to trade with the Boston Uprising to acquire Blase. Now, why they'd want him when they already have Hydration and Jake is beyond me. I personally would have really liked it if the Outlaws signed another true hits game player who's good at Widow, since Lynxer tends to have these hot and cold streaks. But who knows, maybe they still have some more moves in the works. It seems weird for them to want to keep 5 DPS after all. As for this Blase signing, it's not a bad pickup or anything like that, but it's kind of unnecessary unless they plan to make more changes. Blase does have potential, but I don't get why they trade for him since they literally just got Hydration, who can play basically every hero he can but at an even higher level. At this point, I do hope the Outlaws don't stop here. I personally, like I said before, want them to get another hitscan DPS, but along with that, another support player and a tank player would probably help this team go a long way. Now I wanted to address some of the leaks that I discussed in the previous video because a few of them have come true since that video went live. So first off, the Valiant officially announced the departure of Space, Kareev, and Agilities, which further confirms the rumors that the Valiant are looking to build a cheaper roster for 2020, and the Valiant kind of gave us even more confirmation of this after releasing this letter. And I'm not going to read the thing out since it's long, but they made it clear that they are indeed working within a budget like with every other organization. And along with that, they decided to really just stress the fact that they are not broke, unlike the common assumption. The organization also said they're committed to building a new roster full of hidden talent that has been fully evaluated. It's very encouraging to see them post something like this when most of their fan base feels pretty hopeless right now, and for good reason, I'd say. The current state of the team is in shambles, and most believe they will probably be a bottom tier team in 2020 as it currently stands. All of the fan favorite players, with the exception of Custa, have been traded, and there's only 3 people on the team as it currently stands, and that number could very well shrink even more over these next few weeks. Oh, and at the end of the letter, the Valley announced they will be holding an AMA on Reddit to answer questions from fans, so if you're interested in finding out more about their situation, then I highly recommend you visit Reddit this Tuesday. And one other piece of Valiant news I have for you is the official signing of their new assistant coach Goomba, who will be taking the place of Promise, who recently became a free agent. And for those of you who don't already know, Goomba actually was a coach on the Valiant during Season 1, but then left to join the Boston Uprising in 2019. But after leaving Boston, it would seem that both Goomba and the Valiant are interested in once again joining forces. Goomba was part of that successful Valiant team in 2018, so I think he makes for a good addition to the coaching staff. As for Agility, Space, and Kareev, well, Agility is as yet to be signed, but it's heavily implied he will be joining the Toronto Defiant, but nothing is confirmed as of yet. But the Defiant and Gladiators already officially announced that Kareev and Space will be joining their respective teams. And both of these moves are pretty big if you ask me. Space is one of the top non-Korean flex tanks in the game, so you already know he's going to be putting in the work for the Gladiators. But now that begs the question, what's going to happen to Void? Clearly, the Gladiators have no use for him at this point, so it's pretty much 100% confirmed, I'd say, that he's looking for a new team, and Void's a pretty good player. The eye test doesn't always prove it, but the stats most certainly do. But make sure to let me know where you think Void signs in the comment section. It's going to be very interesting to see where he goes. And how about Toronto getting Kareev? That's pretty big too. In the second half of the 2019 season, Kareev had some outstanding performances on that flex support role. He's definitely an upgrade for them at this position, which signals that Neko is likely on his way out. It's sad too, because Neko's a reliable player, but Kareev is just straight up better, let's call it how it is. There is a chance that Toronto could end up re-signing Neko since he's under a team option, but I doubt they will, because why would you waste his talents? I guess you could maybe use him for trade bait, but other than that, they probably wouldn't try and sign him back. In other Toronto player news, though, Logix was confirmed to be on the team for the start of 2020, and as a big fan of Logix, I could not be happier to see this news. I was heartbroken when he couldn't find a new team in 2019, and seeing his triumphant return to the stage end so soon after he worked his tail off in contenders would just be tragic. Logix is a popular player, and he's a pretty consistent hitscan, so this re-signing is good for the roster purpose and from the marketing perspective. And I actually do have one other piece of Toronto news before moving on. So their assistant coach Moby Dick was released after a very short stint with this team that only lasted for the entirety of Stage 4. I'm assuming that he wasn't anything great since he failed to help this team improve much, but I'm also assuming their new head coach, who is French, is looking to have more EU guys be part of his coaching staff. That team is currently only under one head coach and one assistant coach, so another coaching pickup or two will likely be on the way. Next up, we have some brief Guangzhou Charge news to cover. So on the 26th, both Rio and Chara were confirmed to be re-signed for the 2020 season. I know it's nothing crazy, but it's good to see them not lose either of these guys since that would leave a hole at both main tank and main support. Now, if you're a longtime fan of this channel, you know that I don't really think much of Rio or Chara. I don't believe them to be all that impressive, but I wouldn't say either of them are bad at the same time. To put it simply, I don't think either of these guys are star players, but at the same time, they definitely have some upside to them. Rio, kind of like with Void, actually had much better stats than you'd think, and that's pretty evident by the fact that he didn't die a lot, so even though he wasn't a crazy playmaker all the time, at least he wasn't feeding. And although Chara is a forgettable player, at least in my opinion, that's not necessarily a bad thing. He's nowhere near a top tier player, but if people aren't talking about him, that also means he's not feeding or doing anything dumb. Plus, Chara is the team captain, so clearly he is the leader of the squad. They value what he brings both in and out of the game without a doubt. Expect more Charge roster news to come soon, as many of their players are either free agents or currently are under a team option. Now for the final piece of player news I have for you guys. It's another minor thing, but the Washington Justice signed DPS player Tuba on a 2-year deal. And funny enough, I actually had never heard of this guy until this signing was announced, and I'm assuming a bunch of you guys are in the same boat. So to give some background info, Tuba is a South Korean flex DPS who comes from the team Bubble Burster Gaming. The team is now disbanded, but they did compete in Season 2 of Chinese Contenders this year, where they were able to finish in the top 8. And fun fact about this team, They were a mixed roster consisting of both Korean and Chinese talent. So right off the bat, the Justice are getting a new Korean player to their roster who already has experience playing with others who speak a different language, and he has a bit of experience when it comes to speaking English in general, which is a plus. With the Justice releasing Otto, they were in need of an extra DPS player to either back up Corey and Stratus, or potentially get involved with the rotation even. The Justice still have needs to fill out though, since they have no supports at the moment, so there will surely be some more moves coming very soon. That's all of the free agency news I have for you in this video, but before I close it out, the Boston Uprising will be doing another Huck Live Q&A on their Twitch channel on Monday, October 28th at 7 p.m. Eastern Time, so if you want to hear Huck answer some questions about the Uprising, then I recommend tuning in for this. Oh, and he may or may not have said that he may be leaking some sort of announcement, so watch this if you want to potentially get some exclusive Uprising juice straight from Huck himself. And yeah, that's just about going to do it. So if you enjoyed this content and are interested in seeing more, then be sure to hit that like button and sub to my channel if you're new. And while you're at it, feel free to let me know what you think of this news down in the comments section, and if I do end up forgetting something, because I am human after all, or if something big comes out shortly after me uploading this, then make sure to let me know about that as well. And if you want to further interact with me, then make sure to follow me on Twitter at ATPOverwatch, or by joining my Discord through the link in the description. And as always, thank you all so much for watching today's video. I really do appreciate it, and until next time, this is ATP, signing out. Peace.